Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for your Word, your living Word, that can help lead us and guide us and encourage us. And we pray now that you'd use Pastor Izzy to encourage us this morning. Lord, give us what we need for this coming week. Mm-hmm. Lord, appointments that we'll have that we'll be able to share the love of Jesus with somebody that we meet. And Lord, build up our own faith today. We ask that now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you turn with me to Romans chapter 8? We're going to continue our study in this really power-packed chapter. Truly, this is the chapter that the more that I spend time teaching this particular pass through this chapter, I see how this chapter breaks down into such good little devotionals for our year to kick off our year. I mean, we started with how much condemnation is there for us that are in Christ? None. There's the first spiritual note that we got that this chapter introduces, that there is no condemnation. If you're going to move forward in your life, as I know many of you this first week of the year have been making New Year's resolutions, and some of you made the same resolution a year ago. The year previous ago, and the previous year before that, and then that one before that. And you're going, ugh, kick myself. I told myself 3 years ago or I was going to lose this weight, or I was going to do this, or get in better shape, or whatever your resolution was. And this is something that in order for you really to move forward, you need to latch hold of this truth. Because remember, Paul is a teacher who uses a lot of therefores. And therefore is that associative conjunctive that takes the previous thought and builds upon it. Says, because this is true, therefore we can add to that point this. And because that's true, therefore we're going to go on to this. And then he's going to be doing that all through this chapter. And he started with this therefore, that there is therefore now no condemnation for those of us that are in Christ Jesus. There's none. If you're going to move forward, you got to understand, does God condemn you? No. And if God doesn't condemn you, why do we condemn ourselves? You know, the Bible says, by the way, this is actually included in the scripture for you. It says, even if our heart condemns us, we wouldn't do that to ourselves, would we? Kick our own selves, condemn our own selves for our shortcomings. Man, I can't believe I did that again. Kick myself, you know? Even if our own heart condemns us, the Bible says, God is greater than our hearts. And he doesn't condemn us. He says, I don't condemn you. And this is where this truth needs to sink in so I can move on. The Lord isn't holding this against me. I don't need to hold this against me. I just need to move forward. And then we went on to what he moved on to. Remember in Romans chapter 8, he says that the mind then that is set on the flesh, the black dog and the white dog we went over, the flesh being the black dog and the spirit being the white dog, when they're always going to go to dog fight. They're going to go at it with each other. But we saw the secret of how to win. Whenever the flesh battles the spirit, how do we make sure the spirit will win? Feed the spirit. And starve the flesh. That helps too. I mean, make the flesh weak so it's not strong for battle. Don't be feeding your flesh. It says if you put your mind on the things of the flesh, it just leads to death. But the mind that is set on the spirit, this is found in verse 6 of the chapter. It says that mind brings two things. Did you see that? Life and peace. Man, the things of the Spirit are so good for us because it just brings us to that place where life, and Jesus said, I came to give you life and life more abundantly. And that life comes with peace. Now, peace is the peace of Jesus. Remember in John chapter 14, Jesus said, my peace I give thee, my peace I leave with thee. He says, not as the world give I to thee. The peace he's talking about is different than the world. The world's definition of peace is absence of conflict. I don't want any troubles. Then I'll be at peace. If I just didn't have anybody else to deal with, if I could just have this whole island to myself, right? Nobody else to just wreck my day. Then a coconut would fall on your head and you'd be like, I wish there was someone here to help me get me to the hospital. But, you know, it wouldn't work. We think absence of conflict would solve the problem. That's not the peace of the Lord. The peace of the Lord is different. Jesus said, my peace I give you. Now, his peace is different in that his peace is the peace, the assurance that no matter what you're going through, it says he'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. Remember Psalm 23? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of what? Death. I will fear no evil, for what? Thou art with me. I mean, he's with me. And when he's with you, even if there's conflict, isn't it reassuring to know you got the biggest, baddest bodyguard in the planet? I mean, there is no one better to have with you in a dogfight than the Lord. I mean, you got, I've shared this before, but growing up Sicilian, I had an uncle, my Uncle Joe. When he was on the street, you know, in the front, well, even just the front yard with my father or my grandfather, and we were playing in the street, and I was a little runt, and the other boys would start to pick on me. All I had to do was know, I'd just glance over, and there'd be my uncle. He's big. And he was not known for being, I mean, he was, had the reputation of being the bad guy, you know, the real tough guy. And when the guys would start to pick on me, I'd be like, I look over at him and he'd go, you need me? In Italian, he would ask me. And if I said, yeah, he'd stand up, all the kids would run. I'd be like, see, I don't have to worry about nothing because I got him. Now, I know this is a silly analogy, but I'm trying to point out the confidence it gave me, the assurance. I wasn't worried about anybody beating me up then because he was right over there in the yard. I mean, he was just he's as far away as you guys right there. I'd be like, Tio, he'd look over. You need me? Okay, close the boy. All I had to do was go like this. And he'd stand up, and they'd all go, we don't want to fight no more. I'd be like, what's the matter? Nah, 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 nah. See, this is different when you got the big guy behind you. But you guys understand, we have the Lord behind us. He's with us. Now that's a peace to my spirit. And no matter what I face, who's with me? Okay? Now this is what he's introduced so far. We have this peace now. It's a peace so deep. And then he went on, he said, therefore, if we go on and try to live in the flesh, well, then we have to die. But if by the Spirit we put to death the deeds of the flesh, we let the Spirit win over our flesh. And he says, then now we're walking in that newness of life. The life that is not under the law, but under the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. We're under a new law, living law. We got the Lord. And now Paul is going to continue. He said last week, and therefore, we're now called sons, children of God. We are God's children. You didn't just get introduced to some religious organization and you get to be a member, a parishioner. You are introduced to being a child, adopted into God's family. God says, I love you so much, I want to call you my own child. Now, I don't know about you, but I always used to dream, well, it's because I grew up in a poor house. I thought, God, it's not fair. You decided who I was going to be born to. What family? Why couldn't I have been a Rockefeller? Or Bill Gates could have used an extra kid, couldn't he? I mean, somebody with means had money. You know, isn't that God's job to decide whose family we show up in? Why did you do this to me, Lord? And the Lord said, but I called you to be in my family. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I forgot that. See, too busy looking at the temporal stuff and not catching what we went over last week, where Paul said, even this present life, even though it has suffering, it's not to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed. I don't even have to worry about what I go through down here because there is something so great awaiting us. Now, this is the part we got to, and Paul is going to now launch from this part. What awaits us? You know, what does await us as our hope of our faith? Do we have any good things to look forward to as Christians? And this is, if we're going to start off the year, we might as well kick it off on a really good note. Let's pay attention to what do we have that awaits us. Let me show you this morning. We got to verse 18 last week. He said, I consider that the suffering of this present time is not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed. Verse 19 we pick up this morning. It says, for the anxious longing of creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God. The anxious longing of creation? You mean all creation is waiting for some revealing to happen? There's going to be a great reveal. What's the great reveal? It says the sons of God will be the great reveal. His children are going to be, ta-da, here's the kids. But not the kids like some people want to say, why don't you preach that we get revealed down here right now? I read ahead. You know, at the end of the book, it's a much bigger production than just down here. In fact, well, let me show you. Paul's going to tell us some of it right here, so I'll just tie it in with some stuff in Revelation so you get that awesome reveal that well, by the way, that's what revelation means. You understand it, right? Revelation means revealing, the peeling back the curtain, so to speak, to open up what's behind the scenes. You know, the scripture says God is going to send his son for the church in the last days, and the heavens will be rent or peeled back like a curtain. I tell the kids, it's like being in a movie theater. Can you imagine you're watching a show on the screen, and all of a sudden a knife comes through the screen, cuts all the way down, and peels it open. Maybe a sword, better touch, Jesus. And he peels back, and bright, brilliant white light comes out, and there's the Lord behind the screen. He's that close. We just didn't see him because the screen was in the way. That's how this sky is going to be. It's going to just peel back, and we're going to see the Lord. Now, somebody will say, you don't really think heaven's that close to you. I say, wait a minute. Remember the book of Acts? When Jesus was, before he took the disciples out to a mount, it says, and there it says, the heavens opened, and he began to go what? Up. And they stood there going, and the angel said, why are you guys standing around with your jaw unhinged? We translate that to gaping. They're like, and it says, and he was seated, he took his seat, where? At the right hand of the Father. You mean from earth they could stare right at him, sit down in heaven? So, you know, sometimes we think it's so far, the Lord God is so far away. I don't think so. I think it's just, we're blind to the reality, right? I mean, he could be right behind the curtain, right there. And Paul says, the whole creation has been waiting for an anxious, they're just like anxiously waiting. Something great is going to happen. What is the great thing? There's going to be a revealing. Now, who does Jesus come back to this earth with? It says he comes on this flying horse in Revelation, and behind him, myriads upon myriads, that's the Hebrew way of saying 10,000s of 10,000s, which 10,000 is their biggest number, by the way. So they go count up to 10,000. It's an alphabet. Nah, never mind. Somebody like, how do you know this? A is 1, Bet is 2, Gimel, Dalet, is ABC. That's the ABCs of Hebrew. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Get to the 10th one, that's 10. Get to the 11th one, that's 20. Get to the third one. And anyway, you put those letters together in combination. Problem is, they run out. They only have 22 letters. You get all the way up to 10,000, and that's your biggest number when you use that alphanumeric system. So what happens? They go, we got a really big number. 10,000s of 10,000s. That's, you know, their way of saying trillions, you know? I mean, that's just the Hebrew slang for trillions. You know, they just don't have the word trillion. So that's what they used to say. So here, myriads upon myriads of what is following Christ. Do you guys remember this? Who's behind him? The saints. And what does the word saint mean? Believer. All the ones that believed are going to come back with him on these flying horses. Now, this excites my daughter Joy to no end, because my daughter, you know, those of you who know Joy, she always wanted to ride horses when she was little. She always volunteered to go work at the horse ranch up on the Kailua just to, I mean, she would sit there and clean and muck the stalls, do anything just to be around the horses. And when she was little, Daddy, are there going to be animals in heaven? I'm like, pretty sure, honey. Well, will there be horses? No one really wants to know about horses and dogs. That you know, you can tell where a kid's at. This is, do they have dogs and do they have horses? Puppies? Puppies? Are puppies there? Yeah. Well, honey, I don't know about puppies, but I do know the animals they have there, at least what's described in Revelation, way better than the ones we got down here. The horses fly. So they have flying horses. So flying horses? All right, I want to get me one of those. And then, I mean, there's creatures that sit before God's throne. Four different, you guys remember this part in Revelation? The face of a man, the face of an eagle, the face of a bear, the face of a lion, all on one being. And it cries, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And it doesn't have to turn to see because, I mean, you talk about upgraded. So I know some of you think your grandma had eyes in the back of her head. That they use that saying, how did she know what I was doing? She was just perceptive. But those creatures could actually see back that way, see this way, see that way, and not have to turn their head. When I told her that, I said, they're way upgraded than what we got down here. She was like, oh, right. I mean, it's like a kid wanting to go see something cool and new at the zoo. Only it says all of creation is waiting to see this great revealing of the sons of God. This is going to be like, oh, right, man. This is, are we going to be in the same body when the reveal takes place? Do you guys know what those scriptures says here? Moment, a twinkling of an eye, we will be changed. How fast does an eye twinkle? Just a refraction of light, 186,000 miles, meters per second squared, pink, flashes off our bulb, maybe off the back of our cornea, a little flicker of light, and we go, that was a twinkle. That's how fast your body will be changed from this old body. What did Paul say in 2 Corinthians? This corruption will be swallowed up by incorruption. This mortal will be swallowed up by immortality. We're getting new bodies. Anyone up for upgrading? Amen? Man, the older I get, the more I am up for the upgrade. I'm like, this one is wearing out. The aches and the pains and the creaks and the joints. And I'm like, thank you, God. Because let me show you what it says here. Verse 20, for the creation was subjected to futility. Not willingly, it says, but because of him who subjected it in hope. For the creation itself also will be set free from this slavery to corruption into a freedom of glory of the children of God. For we know the whole creation, verse 22 says, it groans, it suffers, the pains of childbirth together. Not only this, but we also ourselves, having the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves. You ever felt like you're groaning because this body has given me a little too much trouble, a little too much pain today? I'm like, amen, Paul, preach it, you know. Even ourselves we groan, yep. It says, waiting eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our body. You know, Christ paid to redeem this body, this old tent. But it wasn't the tent he was interested in. It's the spirit inside the tent. You guys know that your body is Paul refers to it as a temporary building made by human hands. But he says God has an upgrade. I like how Jesus says, I'm going to my Father's house to prepare a mansion for you. Now, some teachers teach that's going to be a mansion like we think of physical buildings. But there's another proposed teaching is that the mansion is instead of being a building, it's a glorified immortal body that will swallow up this temporary tent, as Paul calls it in Corinthians, and replace it. In other words, we'll lay aside the tent. Our spirit will move out of this and into an eternal heavenly body made by God. And to you, I submit that's a pretty good translation. I mean, it bears at least consideration that we think about that God is saying, I'm offering to let you know, and just to put it in terms you get, the body you got now, we'll call it a tent. Tents are good for camping for a while. But if I think of this as a tent, not as a everlasting building, when it starts to, you know, have the tent zipper not work and starts getting little pukas in the rain fly, I don't get as tripped out because it's just temporary. My perspective is different. It's like, yes, this body's wearing out. But see, it says the whole creation's groaning. It says because it's waiting for a reveal of the sons of God in hope. We have hope that this thing is going to get traded in. And what did Jesus, what term? Paul uses it in 2 Corinthians 6. He calls the body a tent here. He calls the body from God a mansion. Nice word picture, huh? We're going to trade in the tent for a mansion. Would any of you would like to trade that? We'll trade these bodies with all of their aches and pains for a body with no pain, no suffering, eternal. I'm like, let's go. But see, when it says all creation has been groaning, waiting for this, and we ourselves even groan, waiting for this, I say amen. It says for verse 24, for in hope we have been saved. But hope, it says, which is seen, that's not really hope. For who hopes for what they have already seen, already has been? We don't hope for something's already done. This is something we're waiting to see done. This is a good way to start off the year, realizing we have something to hope for, something to look for, something to keep the perspective when I don't maybe make it to my physical goals that I set 5 years ago, you know, on my New Year's resolution. I don't have to stress about that, because even if I could get to that goal here, I'm still going to take the tent and trade it in. I mean, I love to stand before you like a, you know, make Arnold look bad. Nice Adonis body, you know, something just. But even if I could reach that goal here on this earth, I'll still trade in this tent. Because I'm pretty sure I'm going to be much better looking in heaven. I'm positive. I know some of you, I've shared this before, but I look in the mirror and I see that reflection. I go, that's not me. I am way better looking inside. Just the spirit isn't lining up with the shell, you know. The shell is decaying, and the inner man, it says, is being renewed day by day. I'm like inside going, I could. My wife's grandmother, she lived to her hundreds, to 100 years. And we were playing, don't ever play Scrabble with someone that has that many years. Okay, they will kick your behind at the Scrabble. They know more words. They've forgotten more words than we could ever learn. She was an avid reader, and nothing had slipped up here. Her body, however, was, you know, had a lot of mileage. And she said, inside, I feel like an 18-year-old. You know, on my spirit, I could go. She wanted to go on the boat that tows you with the little parachute in the back, raises up, you know. She wanted to do that. In like her 80s, 90s, she's like, I'd do that. Inward, there was that spark, that life. There's like, I'm alive. But when she looked in the mirror, she's like, this outer shell's, it doesn't, you know, she's got her little walk-in stick. And she just, because this part is decaying. But we have hope. Not for something what we've already seen. We haven't seen this yet. But we get to look forward to this. And this is where hope becomes truly that substance we need. Without hope, I don't know if you notice this, but this generation that's coming up right now, I noticed they don't have the hopes like we did. They don't even have the hopes like, I don't know, when we were younger, we were taught, you know, you could basically try any business or try any venture or just try, and there's the hope of success. I mean, you didn't go, oh, I can't do it. Probably never work. You're like, hey, dude, we might as well give it a shot, you know? I mean, and there was like kind of this whole culture of, well, at least around me, people that were just like, let's try this. What about this? Why don't we start a store that sells whatever, this new product, or try this. It was just, there was a hope that you could succeed. Like, you just got to try. But the kids I see today are like, I don't see any reason to try. I don't see it. I said, well, by definition, hope is not seeing it done already. It's seeing it as the possibility, the thing what can be achieved. In the mind, you know, with hope, you can actually see stuff that's not yet materialized when you have hope. When you don't have hope, you can't see it. I don't care how good it's described. You're just like, I don't see it. You ever met those people? I call them Eeyores. Like, the sky is falling. I don't think it's going to be a sunny day. You're like, look, the sun's out. I don't know. I don't think I'm going to pull my head out. I got blanket over. I'm not, no sense to even get up. You're like, look. But see, when we don't have hope, we get emotionally paralyzed. We don't even look. We just keep that. We're like this. And hope is gone. Paul says, listen, verse 25, if we hope for what we do not see, it says, with perseverance, you know, to persevere means hang in there. It says that we will eagerly wait for it. And so he goes on, he says, and this is this is as far as I'm going to go, the next two verses. The next two verses say there's something to accompany our hope that we need. Let me show you what it is, verse 26. In the same way, it says, the Spirit also helps with our weakness. Just like hope helps with our weaknesses, so does God's Spirit. It says, for we don't even know how we should pray. Have you ever felt like that? Lord, I don't even know what to pray here. Got a circumstance. I'm not even sure what to pray. But listen to this. God says, I've got my Spirit for you, and my Spirit will intercede for you with groanings. And I like the King James says, with groanings and moanings, too deep for comprehension. I mean, God's Spirit can intercede for a situation. Have you ever been in a place where you can't even put it into words? You're just like, Now, if you have a really good friend and they know you well, and they've been around you so long that you can go, and they go, yeah, I know what you mean. They can actually... That is not a nothing. It's a something, but it's a something that's so deep you can't really quantify. You can't put it into words. But it's still, is it not real? That groaning, that moaning, that, not again. Did you know God's Spirit? That might be all you prayed today. Oh, God. And God goes, I got you. Know exactly what you mean. Because he has his Spirit praying. Interceding means going between us and God as the mediator, the one going to take care of it. Don't worry. He's going to polish up your prayer. I used to tell the kids in Sunday school, you don't know how to pray? Don't worry. Just talk to God as best you can. God's Spirit can help doctor up our prayer. It's his job. Don't worry. He knows exactly. And you know what he does that's really cool? He takes the prayer, what we pray, and it says tweaks it so that we get answers. And the way that he tweaks is very easy, very simple thing. In fact, it's revealed in the next verse, verse 27. He says that the Spirit searches the hearts, and he knows the mind of the Spirit. He knows what it is, what God wants. And it says, and because he intercedes for the saints, according to whose will? God's will. Not according to our will. I know you wish that God would tell his Spirit to take care of your will. God, not thy will, but my will be done. Right? That's our spiritual, not spiritual prayer. Jesus said when we pray, we should pray, not my will like he did, but what? Thy will be done. And I learned this as a young believer. In 1 John, John gives a secret of getting how to get your prayer answered. And it ties exactly to this verse. In 1 John, I was reading this at Bible school in 1979. There was a little, Calvary Chapel had a Bible school up in the Twin Peaks, San Bernardino Mountains. And I'm there and I'm reading this first John, and it said, if we pray anything according to whose will? Our will? No. According to, let me show you, if you want to know where the verse is, it's 1 John 5, verse 13 and 14, or 13, 14, and 15. These things, he says, I've written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you might know, first of all, that you have everlasting life. That's a nice thing to be assured of. And then he said, and this is the confidence which we have before God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And verse 15, this is the key. Yeah, you got him to hear you. But if you ask according to his will, not only does he hear you, it says, if we ask according to his will, then we know he hears us. And if we know he hears us in whatever we ask, then it says, we know we have the request which we have asked from him. Some of you are like, Pastor, I wish I'd get my prayers answered. You know, you seem to pray and get answers all the time. I want my prayers to answer like that. You know, I need a little bit better track record. I'm like, oh, I learned this secret. 1 John 5, 13 to 15. First, you have to believe in his son. Okay, you don't get to do this without believing in his son. It doesn't work. You left out a key ingredient. But if you believe in his son, he made available to you this sweet little key to success of your prayers. All you have to do is say, God, I pray for your will to be done. Here's my situation. Remember, Jesus was going to go to the cross. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, Father, if there's any way that this cup can pass from me, I don't want to drink it. He was talking about the cup of the beatings and stuff he was about to endure. But he says, if it's all right, I'd like to not get beaten. If there's any way we could avoid this, I'd like to pass. Now, that tells me I'm allowed to tell God anything, even if I don't feel like doing what I can see is set before me. But if I do that, I have to end like he did. What did he say? But nevertheless, not my will, but whose will? Thy will be done. In this case, he would drink the cup because he would submit to God's will. Sometimes we're going to have tribulation in this life. But remember, the suffering of this life does not compare to the what? The glory, the future, to be revealed. Keep it in perspective. See, he says, Jesus, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. He looked forward. He set the example what we have to do. We're struggling. We just need to let our eyes move a little bit forward. Look to the future, what is going, that hope we have of the great revealing of the sons of God. Then we can put up with all the stuff down here. We can make it. And if you do want to have an effective prayer life down here, let me tell you, God gave you his spirit to help you in your prayer life. And his spirit will pray according to God's will for you. And the sooner that you can receive this, if you can, I'll end with this note. If you can receive it, who do you think has got a better plan for your life? You or God? I know some of you are convinced you do. Pastor, you don't understand. I got to marry this person. I got to have this job. I got to live in that house. I got to have that mansion. I got to drive that car. You know, the will of a young man. I kind of know about that. Anyway, when you do this instead, God, here's what I would like, but nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. He might take you from Arizona and move you to Hawaii. Shucks, darn. Such a bummer, right? Then he might give you four kids. He might change the whole plan, what you had, to a better plan. See, sometimes we think we have a better plan than God. Let's just be realistic. It's our ego. But I've got news for you. God's got a way better plan for your life if you would just listen to him. He knows what to do. And if you can receive it, asking him for his will to be done in your life, that's solid. That's a good thing for you to do. Because he sees the big picture. He sees everything, he knows stuff you don't even know about yet. And I submit to you, is the greatest way to go. But you're only going to get to know those sweet answered prayers when you come to that place of, God, let me enter into your will. Your will be done. And as soon as you do, you'll see your prayers start getting answered. People be like, whoa, what happened to your prayer life? You're just all rocketed. I learned a secret, 1 John. Just pray according to his will. Then you know he hears you. Then you know you get the answer. See, I don't believe God has any trouble giving us the answer of his will for our lives. The problem really is we just don't pray for it. I was sharing with the kids on Friday night the verse in 1 Chronicles 4:10, Jabez prayed, "Oh God, enlarge my territory. Oh God, bless me," basically. "Oh God, keep me free from pain." It says, and this, by the way, there's only two verses about this fellow in the whole Bible. I don't know if you know this. It's the verse right before it, verse 9 of 1 Chronicles 4. It says, "And Jabez's mother was in pain when she was giving birth to Jabez, so she named him Jabez in Hebrew, which means to be in pain." What a mean thing. Kid, what's your name? To be in pain or to cause pain. I'm a pain causer. That's literally the name in Hebrew what she gave this kid. Can you imagine the scarring that would do to you as you're growing up? What's your name? I'm a pain. How you doing? I'm in pain. It literally is the verb to be in pain. I'm to be in extreme pain, okay? You know, the pain of childbirth. She's like, that kid was a pain to birth. They named him that. What a meanie. I never really picked up on it, but what was his prayer? Oh, God, enlarge my territory, bless me, and cause me to not be in pain. I was thinking, you know, that dude probably had some pains of the heart, rejection, some feelings inside, maybe some suffering, you know, like, man, they named me to be a pain. I'm just a pain. I bring pain. God, he prayed, God, cause me to not be in pain. And you know what it says in the next verse? In that verse at the end? And the Lord heard his prayer. The Lord granted his request. I told the kids, was it really elaborate prayer? Was it so fancy? No. In fact, I submit to you, since we're kicking off the year, that it's not how fancy we pray, it's that we pray. We just need to do it. Just pray. You want to have answered prayers? Then pray. Don't call me to have to do the prayer, because the truth is you can pray. Now, I'll be glad to pray with you. That's no problem. But there's power in praying together. But don't leave it for just when you go to services or, you know, the Bible says, how often should we pray? Without ceasing. Just pray all the time. Just keep a dialogue. Keep an open communique. It's like, how many of you FaceTime with anybody now? The new devices use FaceTime. We have our daughter Joy on the mainland there in North Carolina, and she FaceTimes us all the time. And you can tell when someone's really comfortable on FaceTime because they don't actually stop and stare at the screen anymore to talk to you. They have the screen on, sitting somewhere on the counter, and they're doing whatever they're doing. They're going in and out of the field, and they're just, you're just keeping them company. That's all I'm doing. I mean, she's cooking and doing stuff and going to the fridge, and I don't see her half of the FaceTime call, but she's there. And if you don't keep the conversation, or even if you just are doing something on your side and she's doing something on her side, as long as the line is open, she's good with it. Just don't hang up. You hang up, she'll call you right back. What happened? Where'd you go? Well, we weren't talking. We're just like in this rooms together, but not. No, Dad. See, what does she want? Just that knowledge. That consciousness that you're there. When you think of prayer, don't think of it as like you have to be in the FaceTime call. Like this, you just need to keep the line open. So you can just talk to the Lord about anything, whatever is going on. That's real prayer. That's praying without ceasing. You're just keeping it open. You didn't hang up on him. You didn't cut the call off. You made the call and you left the line open. That's how to pray without ceasing. That's my new analogy for praying without ceasing. Okay? Does that work? Let's do that this week and throw in that part, Lord, your will. So that way you know he hears. That's like having a FaceTime call and making sure that the guy on the other side's hearing what you're saying. Because sometimes I'll hear my daughter's voice coming from the phone. I'm over on the other side of the room. And, Dad, do you still hear me? Are you there? You know, they want to make sure you hear them. You can still hear the thing from across the room, but you want to make sure they hear, and we want to make sure our prayers get heard by God. So, God, we got the line open now. Your will be done. Do you hear me? He goes, I got you. I heard you. And when we know he hears us, guess what happens next? We get answers. I want to start you off on the best note I can for your year, and the best thing I know to do is make it where you have this open, live conversation with God, the living creator, speaking into your life what you need, getting the answers that you've been to the questions you've been struggling with, or the direction. Maybe you just need to know which way to go. What do you want me to do? How should I proceed? Anybody ever have those questions? Lord, here I am. Ask for his will. You'll get an answer. 100% guarantee it. Not because I can actually guarantee, because the Holy Scriptures guarantee this works. And it does work. Anyone give an amen? This works? Amen? Let's close. Father, thanks so much for your word. Lord, as we continue to see next week how many things you cause to work together for the good for us, I just pray, Lord, that this part, what we have laid, this foundation, would be so solid, Lord, we could build on that into the things what come up, and it will just launch us into the next exciting part of growth in our spiritual walk with you. Thank you, Lord, for each person here. Thank you for the dear brothers that work so hard to put this together for the radio and onto the YouTube, Lord. I just pray that that too would continue to bless those, Lord, afar, even from our little reach, what we have here in this community. Expand us to reach anyone else who might need. And I ask that in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.